This is it. Episode. Take a guess, Joe Larson. What episode number is it?
Five. 546.
28.
Well, shit.
Let's start over.
Let's try it again.
Joe, what number is
Let's do this three or four times. Keep going. Try again.
This is No Laugh Track Podcast. I'm Justin Severson here with Joe Larson. Joe, what number episode is this?
526.
Dude, that was 2 weeks ago.
Oh, shit. I like that you just told me what it was. My brain is a colander. I nothing stays in it. It's 528?
528!
Okay, 528, yes.
Welcome.
Okay.
I know everybody's here because they remember when we did 400 and we had that cake at the end. That's, remember that?
I don't.
Yeah.
I told you, my brain's a colander. Was I on that one?
Yes. Okay, let's start off. Let's start over here. Where are you right now?
It's so great to be in my favorite city, St. Louis.
There we go.
He
knows
here.
Where he is.
528 other things that are 528.
Oh, that's you're looking up on your phone right now?
Yes. 528.
The weight of the guy that was ordering food behind me at a Chinese restaurant last night. 2 nights ago, to be correct. 528.
How much food was he ordering? $528 worth of food?
There were a lot of wings.
Oh, Chinese guy eating wings.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Hopefully, he wasn't Chinese. He was at the Chinese restaurant.
Oh, Chinese restaurant.
Yes.
Bat wings. Okay. We should move on. It's.
How are you? Besides having a mush brain.
Well, I mean, I'm not dead yet, and it's lovely here, that's all. That's all. I'm happy to be here.
Yeah.
I'm tired.
Yeah.
I'm old. I'm dying. I'm dying. This is my last show. Tonight, actually. Don't come this weekend if you're thinking about coming to the... Don't come this weekend. I'm not going to be alive.
Stay tuned.
Yeah, stay tuned. We'll see. I don't know. I'm tired.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
I heard you telling Lewis, the owner here, before we got started, mm-hmm. that you have already been doing some comedy today.
Yes, I've had two Zoom
And this
shows.
Is, let me just keep it, for people who don't know, it's mid-afternoon right now on a Thursday, but you've already done shows today.
I have. I've done two Zoom shows, both for PNC Bank. Two different locations, two different areas of the company.
So okay.
I do a ton of Zoom shows. My Zoom show is a little different. What I do is, before the Zoom show, they have sort of a. Did we talk about this? I don't remember.
I don't know.
Okay.
Maybe a little, but go. I'm curious.
So before the
if
show,
it's changed or not.
Yeah. So before the show, what happens is there's a little happy hour-ish thing. People are just getting on chatting, and so I tell whoever the host is, the person in charge, the person who booked me. Just get on there and start chatting. What I do is then I start stealing people's screens from Zoom, right? And I throw them in Photoshop, and then I give out, I basically do a light roast at the end, which is, which I under the guise of awards. We're going to give out some awards, right? So I have best laugher first, always. You always go with a kind one. And then you go, like, if I find somebody who's gotten up and left and it's just their chair, I'll give them the award for least interested. there was one today.
You have not told me this before, by the way.
Okay, there was one today where this lady was in, like, the bottom of her screen. Like, the box was way up here, you know? And so I screenshotted that, and then I said to her that... it looks like she's a peeping Tom in her own box. And then I put her face in my bathroom window, and I said, I expect to wake up tomorrow morning and see this while I'm brushing my teeth, you creep. And then, you know, so it's silly fun things like that. It's Photoshop on the fly, and it's a blast. And the dumber and less realistic it looks, the way funnier it is. It's really fun. Yeah.
So I'm really stupid. I haven't had a job at a... in a, like a corporate job for a number of years. I don't even know if I really have one. Radio is the closest thing I've ever had, so I don't even know if that counts. But so when you're doing this, you're like this morning, you're in your hotel room.
Yes.
Doing this. Are they all in the same? Are they all at their separate desks as well?
Well, there's no, like this one, certain companies still have employees all over the world, and it's way cheaper to have a Zoom show and a Zoom organization meeting thing than it is to fly everybody to a certain location and do all that stuff. So there's still companies where, like the one I did earlier today, or the one I did, what was it, last week, was for an Israeli company that had people in California, South Africa. There was people that were drinking coffee, people that were drinking wine. It was, you know, all over the map. So
Wow.
It's been really fun. It's been really unique and interesting. The weirdest one was one in Bahrain. It was for a Bahraini company, which is a very conservative Muslim country. And it was funny when you saw the screen. Number one, relationship jokes don't really work there, right? When I'm like, my wife's on my ass. They're like, why don't you just hit them? like they don't understand why your wife would be allowed to even speak to you that way. Like what? You know, like I don't understand this, you know? So like none of those jokes work.
Please tell me you found out the hard way because you did that and they were just like staring at
yes,
you.
No,
absolutely. Oh, no.
I was doing jokes about like relationship stuff and they're like, I don't. And the screen, the men and women were both on the screen. The men were sitting forward and the woman was behind them back here. So they weren't even sitting side by side. She was behind them. It was very odd. But the funniest thing, yeah, was that like what do you mean she talks? What do you mean she has opinions? Like what?
Oh boy.
Very interesting.
Oh, wow.
Very interesting.
Wow, you know? Wow, wow.
I'd be like, women should have rights, and they'd laugh and laugh and laugh. They were like, these setups are hilarious. you know. It was a very odd.
A setup that's yeah. Not a setup. Like,
yeah.
It's so
yeah.
Funny.
It's a good joke. No, that wasn't the joke. That's not even. No, that was the.
I'm trying to set you fellas straight
yeah,
here.
Well, come on. Yeah. Uh-huh. They watch TED Talks by women and just laugh. I think that's the funniest.
terrible.
Oh, that's terrible. Oh, my goodness. As you know, no one else knows until right now. I was here last night and saw the show.
Yes.
That was a lot of fun.
It was.
Not the hugest crowd, but that led to some, by the end of it, I knew about quite a few audience members, and it was very interesting.
Well, you know, that's the beauty of a small audience, is then you can do a lot of fun crowd work. If there's a ton of people here, it's not so intimate, so you can't, you know, you have to tell jokes that When it's the size of your living room, you can really kind of rip on people and have a good time. It's like a Zoom show in that way. And I think that muscle has actually really helped my crowd work a lot.
It has to have.
A lot. So, yeah, it was a blast. Limp Bizkit over here in the corner, he left. He goes, "It was the best show I've ever seen." And he just gave me $20. And I was like, all right.
Get out of here.
All right. Listen, I just doubled my income for the night.
Way to go.
This is amazing.
Wow. And this is like an unsolicited tip. That
yeah. Just here.
Impressive.
I liked what you do.
Impressive. Great.
Yeah.
Way to go.
I like the best one I ever got was when I first started doing comedy. I was in like Corvallis, Oregon. And I think it was opening for Kermit Appiah. And it was in this big dance hall thing. It's, you know, one of those terrible shows when you first start. And there was a big moat of space between the audience and you. So it was like, it was actually shaped kind of like this, but then there was 30 feet, and that's where you performed. It was way over there. And some guy was in the back being chatty or whatever, and I hit him with a couple, you know, crowd work insult things, got him, zinged him, everybody laughed, sort of thing. And then I start to go in my next bit, and then I just see an enormous man in a cowboy hat stand up and walk towards the center of the room and then turn. And I've got the lights here, so he's backlit, so all I just see is just a massive, he was probably 6'4", and cowboy hat, cowboy boots, shit kicker looking guy, comes walking straight at me, just ka-chunk. Chunk slow, doesn't go fast. I'm like, oh my god, I get the shit kicked out of me by a huge. And he comes up, and I'm of course trying to dissolve the situation before it even happens.
Yeah.
And he just goes, "That was good, man. That was good. You got me. As for you," and he hands me $100 bill, and I was like, wow, I should be an asshole way more often.
Yeah.
That's great.
Wow.
Doesn't work with the cops, but it works everywhere else.
You don't have $100 for me?
Yeah,
no.
Come on.
You owe us $160,
yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, shit.
That is very funny. What do, after shows, well, first of all, we should point out, as I said to our friend Ali Sultan, who was working with you last night, he's such a big shot these days. I kind of wasn't expecting him to be here this week.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Ollie always comes out for me.
Of course.
I love Ollie.
Yeah, yeah. I'm very, very happy to see him.
Yeah,
perform.
He's the best. He's wickedly funny. He's a sweetheart of a guy. And he's a good friend. I like Ollie a lot.
Yeah.
I met him when he was opening here. He was, I think he was hosting?
Oh, probably.
Hosting. And we went indoor skydiving.
That's right.
Yeah, that was a blast. And he said it was the scariest thing he ever did. I went, you were brought up in a third world country ravaged by war, and this is the scariest thing. You've been shot at, and this was the scariest? And he said, absolutely.
Not what you'd expect.
No.
Absolutely not what you'd expect. Yeah, so I don't see him. He's just like out on the road so much. I don't see him a lot here, so it's nice to see him here. But I'm curious, your talents, your first night, last night. What do you do to, like, right after the show to kind of wind down? Did you go out and have drinks? Do you go and just watch a movie? Go play video games? What do you go do?
Mostly hookers and blow.
Hookers and blow?
Yeah,
even in Minneapolis?
Well, you know, they're dressed warm. but you ask enough. I have another corporate gig that I'm doing next week where I'm hosting their big award show, and I have to create video slides and all that stuff for it. So I'm in the room working.
So you go from doing this to going home and doing work.
Go work. Work some more.
Come on.
Yeah. I know. As a comedian, a lot of people think we don't work, and because we rarely do. But
you're shattering that.
But if you're not successful enough,
you end up
having to work for a living. So,
after 11 p.m. sometimes.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely. Well, you know, you're so jazzed up, and you already got the comedy going, so you're like, all right, let's get back there and... So,
well, yeah, I mean, that's why I ask, is because, I mean, I know that it's not from performing, but I just know, like, you know, you do anything late in the evening, you know, like, sometimes it's hard to relax afterwards. Yeah.
So, I've been trying that, you know, you meditate sometimes. Do you meditate?
I always tell myself I'm going to start doing that, and every time, but I don't. I never, ever do.
Okay, you've never meditated?
No, not really.
You want to try it right now?
What during on this podcast?
It'd be a real boring podcast.
I don't know if this is the right
How
place
was the
for
podcast.
That.
Well, it was good for about 5 minutes.
Yeah, I mean,
and then there was like 30 minutes of just silence, and
I think both of them fell asleep.
Yeah,
I think both of them fell asleep. We talked last time you were here. You were told me about you had gone to Dubai to perform, and then you have since gone back.
I did. I went one more time. And I went with my buddy Paul McCaffrey, very funny comedian out of the UK.
Okay.
My friend Megan Hanley. And we had a very good time. Didn't get as wild as the time before.
That's exactly what I was going to ask you.
Because the time before, it was in COVID. It was like one of the first shows since COVID had hit that these people did. And so Dubai was empty. Like, there was no tourists there. Very few. And so it was a really quiet town, but because of that, you can get pretty wild because every place has a special, drink special. There's the hookers are, just everywhere. You couldn't go anywhere without being solicited. It was crazy, crazy. Walking down the street, me and my buddy Peter were walking down the street, and this lady goes, "I'll fuck both of you for, you know." I was like, "What? No, what? But what? How do you?" That seems odd. And we're just trying
Do
to
you have the time?
Yeah, exactly. We're just trying to get a euro. And she's like, "Hey, you want to? I'll fuck both of you at the same time." What? Same time? How busy are you? You're multitasking.
Squeeze you in.
But this time, it was like it was a much more normal city. Big and ridiculous. And
same lady, but the prices have gone up?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. She's only doing one at a time now. She's,
I'll do you both for 300 or one for two.
Yeah, it was a good time. Paul was great. We went to Abu Dhabi though. We had never been there. Abu Dhabi's Dubai is the tourist epicenter, and Abu Dhabi is sort of the cultural epicenter. It's where the big mosque is. It's way more conservative.
Okay, cuz you said last time that you didn't really see You saw nothing but tourist stuff, basically.
Yeah. So this time we got to see a little bit more culture, which was lovely.
Okay.
We went to the largest mosque in all of the UAE. It might be the largest. I don't know. It was gorgeous. Built entirely with slave labor, as everything good is.
Yeah, I mean, the extravagance, the money spent there is just insane, right? Like the things you see, like.
Yeah, absolutely. It's like a child built a city, like a petulant child. I want a building with a hole in it right there. Well, that's ridiculous. Why would you put it there? And you're, okay, all right, fine, we'll do it. Don't hit me.
Can you use that as a joke there, and then they laugh at that, or will they be offended by that?
Yeah, absolutely, because most of the people at the shows are expats.
Okay.
The 90% of the country is not from the country.
Sure.
So No one's from there. Yeah. It's just, it's pirates. It's just a bunch of pirates. There's no income tax. So everyone went, I'm going to go there and make a ton of cash and pay no taxes on it.
Wow.
And until recently, the cost of living there was very inexpensive if you did it right. So, you know, I met tons of people from Cleveland. You know, like there's an engineer I met from Cleveland. Him and his wife were both from Cleveland. They're like, no, we were working there. And then we got an offer for three times the amount of cash out here to be engineers. And we had to pay zero taxes on it. So we live here now.
Sounds like a good plan.
Okay.
Sounds like a good plan. You're still living in New Jersey, correct?
Jersey, baby.
Yeah.
Love it.
Homeowner.
Absolutely.
Yeah. What have you, you told me last time you'd done some tile on the roof.
Yep.
Any other new manly stuff you've done in the last year to risk your life saving money at the house?
Yeah, I mean, I put in a water softener. I retiled the entryway.
See? Look at this guy.
Built a treehouse, rewired the garage, and started a carpentry business as well. And so now I build stuff for people.
So I saw a picture of some chairs you had worked on or something on Facebook, probably.
Yeah, so my buddy owns Into the Void Antiques, which is a great little store in Jersey City. And he'll oftentimes come across these pieces that are pretty well damaged.
Sure.
But there are these iconic pieces, mid-century modern pieces from the original designers. And so he always has me just rebuild them. So I have to do wood matches and make sure that the wood is the same wood as the wood they used, and then weather it and create it so that it looks exactly the same and put it all together the way that they would have so that there's no metal. It's all used with dowels and glue and things like that. So it's a fun project.
How have you learned how to do that stuff?
Dude, I don't know how to do shit. Are you kidding me? You got enough confidence. People will let you do stuff. 100%. 100%. Yeah, I don't know how to do comedy. I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know anything. I'm a complete moron, and somehow people pay me to do things. I have no idea why. They shouldn't. It's a poor choice on their behalf. I think they're dumber than I am. I think that's what it is.
I've never felt so inspired listening to someone than hearing this.
Listen,
right now.
I'm gonna go on a speaking tour.
You should.
You may be a fucking moron, just like me. But if you have enough confidence, other morons will believe you. Go out there and ruin somebody's life.
There you go.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Wow. Well, that's impressive. No skills, and you just kind of get it done.
Yeah.
And
Well, I mean, so my dad rebuilt our entire house when I was a kid. I was around that.
Oh, wow.
My
okay.
uncle was a Finnish carpenter in the Northwest. He worked on all the rich people's houses, so Paul Allen, Bill Gates, things like that. So I would work with him, like, on spring break and stuff. So I did develop a skill set to build stuff. And in high school, I built a skate park in Seattle. That was my senior project. I designed all the skate park. And
is it still there?
The bowl is still there. It was a test run in Ballard, which is a neighborhood just north of downtown Seattle. It happened to come together, a confluence of all the wonderful things. There was a group of parents that were like, we want a skate park in North Seattle. And then there was some landscape architects that they had hired to kind of build designs, but they didn't know how to build skate parks. And then I came in going, I want to build a skate park as my senior project. Happened to be that they already had gotten sort of like a rough okay on funding to a certain amount, and so then I had to design a skate park within those financial parameters. And so we built out a skate park with all kinds of fun boxes and ramps and things.
You were
like
obviously
that.
A skateboarder?
Yes. And got that built. And so I've done a lot of build stuff. And then my brother-in-law is a architect as well.
Oh wow.
And he works on He was the lead architect for the Montana Preservation Society. This is a very exciting podcast.
No, I'm gonna hop in and ask you something about. Did the architect help with this? You said a treehouse. Like how
yes.
fancy is this treehouse?
The treehouse is relatively rudimentary, but he did help with certain parts of it. But being on a ladder with a chainsaw is terrifying. Here was my favorite one. So. When we first moved into this house.
Isn't that? I think I've seen that in America's Got Talent.
Yeah, it's either America's Got Talent or America's Dumb or Faces of Death. One or the other. When we first moved into this house, I was laying in bed and my wife goes, "What the hell is that?" And something was scurrying in the attic, in the soffits. And so I was like, "Well, it's probably squirrels." And then we saw them going up and down this tree in the front yard. And the tree's about 100 feet tall. It's a big tree. So the next day, I look online. I find that squirrels always leave their nest during the day. So I go, well, they're gone. Time to cut this goddamn tree down. And my neighbor comes out as I have a chainsaw in my front yard. He goes, the hell are you doing? And I go, I'm going to chop this tree down. And he goes, you got a permit for that? And I got one right here. Hold on. and he goes, well, how are you going to do it? I go, I'm going to chop it down. And he's like, all right, dummy. You got to do it in sections. And I was like, yeah, I was going to, but I just need you to hold this rope. So I climb up above my roof line about 60 feet, and I tie the top of the tree off with a rope, and then I climb down 10 feet. And my thought is I'm going to notch out the side that's on away from me.
Mm-hmm.
And then, and I don't have a harness. I'm sitting on tree branches with a chainsaw. And then I'm going to start to cut this direction, but I'm only going to get halfway through. And then I'm going to climb down, and we're both going to pull on it, right?
Sure.
So I notch it out. Everything's going great. And then I start to cut this direction out here. And the tree starts to fall. And now I don't know if it's going to hang on to itself, and the branches are going to hit me in the stomach and kick me 60 feet down with a running chainsaw or what. And so I just grab that tree, and I hug it as hard as I can, and that thing falls. And then I go climb down, grab the rope, and do it again and again and again. And my neighbor, he's a 78-year-old black dude named Butch, he started laughing so hard. He goes, I heard about tree huggers, but I've never done seen one in real life. You hugged that tree so hard, I never seen somebody shit their pants on 60 feet in the air with a chainsaw. It's the best. Great. Great, but that was the most terrifying moment of my life, I think.
I can only imagine.
Yeah.
And that was not very smart.
No, it was the dumbest thing, or one of the dumber things I've done.
Where was your wife when this was happening, telling you not to do this?
Inside. She was inside. She doesn't watch.
Things are closed. You're just like, he's out there. I'm going to listen for a second. Hopefully
I have life insurance. I'm worth $1 million dead. So
that's
she's
right.
She's like, if he dies, we get $1 million, then we can get the tree cut down.
Two for one.
If he doesn't die, then the tree's cut down. So the tree's getting cut down either way.
Hilarious. I'm going to completely change directions here. Do you use Facebook a little bit, right? Here and there? Wow.
Have you used the social media, right?
That have bailed on it. It's a valid question.
Have you heard of the internet?
It's a valid question.
Yes. Okay. I'm wondering where this is going to go.
Are you a member of any groups?
Many.
Many, such as?
Oh, geez. There's woodworking groups, there's entertainers groups, there's all kinds of groups.
Okay.
Yes.
Side note, I just thought of this. I've joined many, many groups on Facebook over the years, and inevitably, members of those groups annoy me enough that I end up leaving.
Oh,
but that's not even what I was going to bring up.
Oh.
One of the groups I'm a member of is a neighborhood one where you give away free stuff.
Those are the best.
You probably do the same?
Absolutely.
Right.
I love the neighborhood ones, especially because I live in a pretty affluent area. And so, number one, the things they give away, awesome. But number two, the complaints are fantastic.
Okay.
The biggest issue in my neighborhood is, should we ban gas leaf blowers? And people are furious. Oh, my goodness. They're ruining everything. It's the worst possible atrocity known to man. And that's how I know that I'm the poorest person in my neighborhood, because I don't have an opinion. That's a status of wealth that I don't think I'll ever achieve.
Interesting.
You have so much money and you have so little problems that you're like, you know what? I got to focus on leaf blowers.
Yeah.
That's my big issue. Okay.
Well, those rich retirees, yeah. Oh, it's disrupting their TV time during the day.
It's amazing.
So I'm a member of this group that, people post free stuff that they're giving away. You're like, oh, this is, I just got a new vacuum. Here's our old one, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
I want your opinion on this one.
Okay.
This was from last week.
All right.
It was a half gallon of unopened milk.
Great.
That was 2 days expired.
Okay. So what it was cottage cheese almost. Would you like some soon-to-be cottage cheese? That's, I think you're just looking at the half gallon of milk as half empty.
Come on.
It's, come on, look on the bright side of life.
So I don't know if I was not involved in this one. I don't know if it got picked up, but there was quite a conversation of people following up on whether it had been refrigerated consistently, because it was taken out for a photograph to be posted on Facebook.
Well, what I like about that, too, is, it's as much money to go drive your car to that person's house and get a free gallon of milk as it is to, when the next time you're at the grocery store, just get a gallon.
Great point.
There's no reason for it. It's complete ridiculousness.
So you would go for the expired milk just if it was like on your block. That's what you're saying.
Yeah, what I'm saying is I would videotape the entire thing.
Yes.
I love that premise. Honestly, you know what I would do? I would then put it back on the free group and
see how far it goes.
See how far it goes. Absolutely. Regifting this.
There, because you really got to know people's opinions on expiration dates, like whether they're legit or a bunch of shit just trying to get us to buy more stuff.
So sell by date. How do you feel about it? Do you eat something on the sell by date?
Oh, yeah. I usually don't worry about that.
Yeah. I got a feeling.
Mm-hmm. and that's financial as well, let's be honest. I, too, don't have an opinion on gas leaf blowers.
No, when I see a person with a gas leaf blower, I'm like, how'd they afford that? That's amazing, you know?
I'd have to drive that to work.
Yeah, I got a rake. That's what I got.
Yeah.
Which we did get a leaf blower. It's the most powerful leaf plug-in electric leaf blower you can buy. It's a Toro. And so when we got it, I was like, this thing really does push some air. And so I was like, I called over my daughter Gigi. She was 5 at the time. I go, here's what we're going to do. You're going to sit on this skateboard, and you're going to hold this thing backwards, and I'm going to turn it on. And then at a certain point, you'll go so far that the extension cord will just rip out, and you'll slow down, and then you'll stop. And so we put her on
the street. It
worked? Absolutely. It was great. It was great. I mean, she thrusted forward, and then the back lifted up, so then she had to angle it back down. But, yeah, she was cruising. It was great.
That's fantastic. Mm-hmm. Bring that along next time. I want to try.
Yeah, I will. Yeah,
please.
What do you got in your carry-on? It's just a leaf blower. Don't worry about it.
Electric. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. My wife and I were at a garden center the other night looking for some stuff. I had a gift card. Everything was still so expensive. I couldn't even get anything with a gift card. That's a whole nother story.
Wow.
Yeah.
How much was the gift card?
Weighed $50, and we wanted to get some. I'm a Christmas light guy at my house now, Joe.
Oh, yeah?
Yes.
Did you go like Clark Griswold style?
I'm like beginner. We just have lights. It's pretty simple.
No,
but we're thinking
things.
About going into the blow-up thing, mm-hmm. and we went to a garden center, and I had the gift card from a year ago. $50 was not enough to get one.
No.
I'm more of a Walmart inflatable than a independent store inflatable.
I think you just got to, you know what? You show up late at night in someone's yard, those inflatables are free.
If you only knew how much that happened when we were in college. Oh, my God. If you only knew.
It's not like
if Duluth only knew.
If there's not like something that stays blown up. The moment you unplug it, it drops. So then you just got to
true.
Get the hell out.
That's very true. Mm-hmm. So we're at this garden center. I did end up buying something.
Okay, what'd you buy?
A timer. Like a little timer for my lights.
Okay.
You know, for the Christmas lights.
Okay.
Little one-thing timer. Yeah. And use the gift card. That doesn't matter. The girl's checking me out, and this is what I'm getting to, is
nice.
We do the transaction, and she's like, I was about to walk away, and then it clearly hit her that it's the holiday season, and she's at work.
Okay.
So then she's like, have a nice night. And then I took a few more steps, and she goes, happy holidays.
Oh, Jesus.
What is going on?
Jesus. She just pulls a razor blade out. What are you doing? I don't want to live anymore. Wow.
Have you ever had a retail job where you've had to fake being happy like that?
I've never had a job.
And she was terrible at it.
I've never had a job. Never. I was a lifeguard in high school. That's about it. That's the closest.
You didn't have to put on a happy face to be a lifeguard.
No, you get to tell people what to do. Stop running. I'm an adult. I don't give a shit. I'm a kid. You're not allowed to run. It's great.
What do you do? There must be days when you wake up and you're like not wanting to perform and stuff. How do you get yourself in the mindset?
Oh, drugs.
Stop.
Drugs. Mostly drugs and alcohol. Next question.
Do you just look at the balance of your checking account? You're like, I have to snap into this and be ready, right?
We got to figure this out. Yeah. I mean, luckily, again, I don't have to be nice. You saw my show last night. I'm not polite to anybody.
Oh,
I'm kind of
true.
A dick.
There was someone, we're not going to get into it because we talked about it in the past. If people want to go to the last time you're here, listen to the episode, you give great details of your vasectomy.
Oh, yes.
I listened back to it and cringed again
because
there are parts where I'm like, oh, God, no.
Yes.
But what I want to ask you about is there was a gentleman in the audience last night. The vasectomy talk came up, and he said he'd had one already. I think he was only in his mid-30s.
Yes. Yes.
Are you
man.
So? This is what I want to know. Are you hearing that? You must be asking audiences about that. Are you hearing more and more younger,
absolutely.
Lower numbers?
Yeah. Which is, I mean, that only from good people. you know, you come to an affluent area. That's the thing. It's like white trash does not get vasectomies. They're like, fuck it. I'm not paying for these babies anyway. Why would I? You know, it's people middle class or above that are go, these kids are expensive,
sure,
you know?
Sure.
But, you know, if the government's paying you for having kids, then keep banging them out. You can Nick Cannon your life away. He has 12, Nick Cannon. If there should be a mandatory vasectomy for anybody, it should be Nick Cannon. That's correct. 12 children. 12.
What if he had one and it didn't work?
I don't think it would. Maybe he's had one. His sperm is so strong. Yeah.
Yeah.
He impregnated a lady just that was watching AGT. She wasn't even. It was amazing.
Welcome to the Mass Singer. This is my next baby mama. I was just surprised when the guy said 35 and he'd already had one. Like, oh,
yeah,
there's just some. I wasn't making adult decisions like that at 35. I was not ready to be prepared. Yeah. It goes without. So this, I should. This goes without saying. I wasn't ready to make decisions like that at 35.
No. Or 45. But had you had children?
Yes.
Isn't that crazy?
Yes.
That's crazy. You're like, I'm not ready to make decisions. I can bring a human being into this world, but I shouldn't make
decisions. I mean,
decisions.
If we want to go there, I wasn't convinced that I was ready for that. That was the whole, are you ever ready? Let's give it a shot.
Yeah, well, yeah, that's insane.
And then we got divorced.
Yeah, well, that's how dumb ladies are. They're like, this guy is not qualified to be a father, but I can fix him.
Right.
No, you can't.
Right.
No, you can't.
Right. Every now and then I think back to this girlfriend I had when I was like in my early, mid-20s I was very serious at the time. She was 5 years older and was in that I'm ready to get married time.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just getting started with a job in radio.
Yeah.
And she flat out was like, you're never going to make enough money to support me.
Yeah.
This isn't going to work.
Lucky guess, right?
She, so far, I mean, wasn't that much off.
Yeah.
She ran into her someday and be like, you didn't even inspire me with that.
Hey, no, come on.
I'm right where you thought I was going to be, but not even in radio anymore.
Can you? Yeah. She was like what does she do, read tarot cards? Is she
That was Kreskin, by the way.
You were never going to make enough money to support me. That's an old school idea, too.
I mean,
I like that she was like, I'm also not going to make enough money to support me, and therefore I need to use my vagina as a bank account.
Yeah, I don't know how things ended up for her, but I'm sure just perfect.
Yes, just perfect.
Let's put a bow. I want to ask you a couple more things. I'm going to see how this goes, ending the podcast with this these days.
Okay.
This is going to be, you're going to be... patient number one.
Uh-oh.
All right. This is going to end the podcast. So, just curious about things you want to share with the listening audience and me. Is there anything you're reading these days? Anything you're reading?
No.
No. Because you don't read books? Because I don't.
No, I do read books on occasion. I think I get through about 4 a year.
Okay.
That's about it.
That's about...
To be completely honest.
And that's about 3.5 more than me.
Yeah, okay, all right. Fair
okay.
enough. Yes.
Fine. All right, that's information
four
I'm looking for.
A year. Okay, all right.
All right. Anything you're watching that's really good?
No.
No? Do you watch much television?
You know what? I watch TV to go to bed sometimes, but you don't want something good.
So what's your old favorite then that like my wife puts on The Office or Friends? What do you put on? Something that's familiar, right?
You know what I like to do? I like to watch that show Alone. Do you know that show? Where they drop like 10 contestants in the middle of the Arctic and they don't get to eat for like 9 months and they just try to for $500,000, which seems like so little amount of money. Because normally they're out there for like 100 days. They lose like 100 pounds
of
body weight. They're almost dead.
Yeah.
And then... Only one of them makes $500,000. And I'm like, that's just, after taxes, what's that, $250? It's like, that's not even enough money to do to almost die
sure.
for.
You cares. Wouldn't do that as a job for that much money.
No,
right? Yeah.
I wouldn't, yes. And they're like, this is it. This is the thing that's going to make my world. I'm like, Jesus Christ, try anything else. But what I like to do is I like to watch that show because they're just starving, emaciated, and I just eat. The whole time I just
Stop.
Eat like junk food and shit food, and I don't know what it is, but I'm just like, oh, I'm doing it for you. I put on like 20 pounds since watching it.
Tastes so much better.
Yeah.
Do you play video games?
No.
No.
Never have. Not a video game.
Not a video game, guys. And then how about listening to podcasts, music? What do you got?
I only listen to your podcast all of the time.
I'm the one. This is the correct answer.
And
bullshit. That's my mom.
I will. You know what? There is a new artist that I just got a hold of that I absolutely love.
Here we go.
He's Canadian and hilarious. It's as if it's like a Canadian country version of Flight of the Conchords. And his name is Waylon Napadogian. Napadogian. Waylon Napadogian. And he's got very funny songs like Oh Yeah, No For Sure, Bud. High on Weed. No Wonder Sharon Took the Kids. Stuck in a Porta Potty. They're great. They're wonderful.
Sound like a little country there.
It's like country Flight of the Conchords. It's fantastic. It's absolutely hysterical. And he's only got like 11,000 downloads or something on... Yeah, like only 15,000 people listening to him, but he's fantastic. He'll be huge. He'll be huge.
Well, based on you mentioning it on this podcast.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I'm expecting royalties from him.
Yeah, you're welcome, Bogosian, or whatever your name was. Yeah, you're welcome, buddy. All right, anything else we should be mentioning then? Come to the shows if you've survived today. If depression doesn't kick in so much that you... stick around and do the shows this weekend. People should come to the shows.
Survive.
You,
okay.
Yes.
No, come to the shows. If you come to the shows, I'll stay. I'll live. it is a beautiful day in Minneapolis. Don't go outside. Come inside.
Mm-hmm.
It's lovely.
Yep. I was here night one of Joe here at Acme, and it was a lot of fun. Absolutely out of fun. What else are you going to do? Come over to Acme and see some comedy.
Absolutely.
All right.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Joe.
Thank you, buddy.